Well, good morning. Good morning. Good morning. My name is Trevor Hughes, and I am the president and CEO of the IAPP, the International Association of Privacy Professionals. And as my name and title would suggest, we are going to talk about privacy today. The IAPP is the world's largest privacy organization. We represent 22,000 privacy professionals around the world in over 80 countries. We do all the things that professional associations do, conferences, certifications, those sorts of things. What we wanted to cover today was how this issue of privacy is being applied, managed, dealt with within major organizations. And so we have the incredible benefit, the privilege of having three of the top leaders in the field of privacy in our panel today. Our format is going to be largely conversational. We hope to explore many of the issues that these major organizations are struggling with regards to privacy. We hope to engage you. There are microphones in the audience. If you have questions, please do jump up and stand at the microphone. I will do my very best to get to both microphones as the session goes on, but know that there may be a lot of interest and it may be tough to get to all of the questions. And with that, why don't we dive right in? I'm going to run down the panel really quickly and tell you who we have, but then I'm going to ask each of our panelists to introduce themselves, introduce their role within their organization, and maybe tell us a little bit about how they arrived in a privacy role, because it is a nascent profession. It is still just 15 or so years old, certainly in the United States. So very quickly, we are privileged to have Aaron Egan from Facebook, Keith Enright from Google, and Brendan Lynch from Microsoft joining us today. And with that, why don't we start with Aaron?
Great. Well, hello, everyone. And I apologize if my microphone falls off during this session. And if I, but I'm going to try to keep it on. My name is Aaron Egan. I am Chief Privacy Officer of Facebook. I've been at Facebook for 3 years. I'm a lawyer by training. I started out as a tech policy lawyer in Washington, D.C. in the 1990s, so I was around doing a range of tech policy issues from H-1B visa immigration issues to CDA, copyright, trademark, and then privacy. And really, the consumer protection and privacy issues really spoke to me, and so I built that practice at a law firm and then joined Facebook about 3 years ago. I'm in the public policy area of Facebook, so we have a legal team, and the way we've structured ourselves is we have lawyers, but I'm on the public policy side. So why and what does that mean? Well, we want to make sure always that we're doing things legally by the letter of the law. But so we have lawyers who focus on that, privacy lawyers, a big team of lawyers. But my job is to really be looking around the corner. And so I have a team on the public policy side who's in the field around the world. And our job is to be listening, talking to people, academics, advocates, policymakers, and others to understand the latest concerns around privacy and bring those back to our product teams to make sure that we build products with those issues in mind. And then also we're out there talking with them about what we do and how we think about privacy. So that's how we're structured at Facebook.
Keith.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Keith Enright. I am the legal director for privacy at Google. How I got there, I had sort of a circuitous path into privacy. I came out of law school, did a few startups first in the security space, including. And then I went to a couple of Fortune 100 companies as a chief privacy officer as well before joining Google. Now at Google, as I had said, I lead the legal privacy team. I have a counterpart who leads privacy for product and engineering. Collaboratively, we, along with our partners in the public policy organization, try to really drive a culture of privacy compliance as well as innovation at Google.
Brendan.
So Brendan Lynch, Microsoft, and it's a little different to the others. I'm not a lawyer by background. I did more of a business degree and got into quality assurance and then business consulting for a number of years. Got into the privacy field about 15 years ago. First as a consultant, went through a technology startup in Boston before coming out to Microsoft 11 years ago. And the place where I sit in the organization now, it's shifted a little bit, but it's within the legal and corporate affairs team. And similar to these guys, we have a little bit of a split between, there's a team of privacy attorneys who do the day-to-day legal privacy work, and then I sit alongside them where I lead the program all up, which means setting the requirements from a policy standpoint, helping the product teams with privacy-enhancing technologies and the like, and then engaging externally with the range of stakeholders that we engage with.
Great. So the complexity of privacy increases, it seems, every day. And with that complexity, risk increases. And so I know all of your organizations are struggling with those risks every single day. And I think we've already heard across this panel that there are many aspects of privacy within an organization. There is a public policy, external-facing government affairs type aspect. There is a legal and compliance aspect. There's an operational management aspect. In some organizations, there's even an engineering and an IT aspect. Maybe we could start with Keith. Tell us how all of that is structured inside Google. How did those various pieces of the privacy management puzzle come together? What do they look like? And how does it work up through Google?
Sure. So I don't think we have everything in terms of privacy arranged in the way that it's going to be arranged forever going forward. We continue to learn. One thing at Google, if you look at our privacy program, it really does reflect lessons learned from things that we didn't always get right. We made some mistakes. We launched products in ways that were imperfect. And as a result of that, not only to address legal requirements, but also to make sure that we were consistently bringing products to market that were meeting the expectations of our users, giving them the value that they were looking for, but also handling information in ways that were consistent with their expectations. To do that, we really did implement this bifurcated program where we have legal compliance professionals working closely day in, day out with engineering and product professionals, really trying to identify privacy issues, concerns, opportunities as early as possible in the development cycle. So we do that by engaging really closely with the product teams, helping them identify those kinds of privacy issues, driving consistent documentation, making our privacy program externally accessible so that when we're called upon by governments or others around the world to demonstrate how we are delivering on our privacy promises to users, we can do that consistently. And we do that, again, through a close partnership between both legal folks as well as engineers, product people, and other folks who are really up to their elbows in the technology.
So, Keith, in that design process that you describe, are the engineers doing something like a privacy impact assessment? Is that the tool that they're using?
Yeah, and the nomenclature, I think, varies from company to company. At Google, we have something called a privacy design document.
Okay.
So whenever a new product or feature is conceived of, the tech lead for that project has to complete a document that includes a lot of information about how information is going to be collected, processed, shared, used, deleted. That then goes into a group of subject matter experts that really understand not only the specific technologies that are brought to bear in that product area, whether it be self-driving cars or Google Glass or something else, people who really understand how things work in that space, but are also familiar with privacy issues more generally. They'll then work with that team in partnership throughout not only the conception of the product, but its ongoing development, and then ultimately its implementation, and then iteration of the product over time to make sure that we are remaining cognizant of the privacy challenges as the product continues to evolve.
Excellent. Brendan, maybe you could tell us about Microsoft and how privacy is managed there.
Yeah, it's in many ways very similar to what Keith outlined. What we've found over the years is for a large and diverse organization like Microsoft, and with the need for these privacy considerations to be really contemplated deeply at design time, the only way you can do that is if you embed people within the engineering teams, within the various business groups, who are skilled up on privacy and can ask those right questions at the right time. We have a similar process where we call it the privacy review, where these embedded privacy professionals are accountable for whenever there's a new product, feature, or service that introduces a new collection or use of personal data, that there is a privacy review of that against our requirements and that's addressed at design time. So it's a very distributed model of people embedded, and then we sort of coordinate that whole community centrally, setting the requirements and then providing the the capabilities for them to escalate issues and get more specialist advice, either to my team or to the specialist attorneys if it's a legal issue.
So, Brendan, how does the risk assessment work for that escalation? Like, when does it land on your desk? You know, when does a privacy impact assessment identify something as radioactive? What's the mechanism you use for that risk assessment?
The mechanism we largely use is a lot of ongoing dialogue between these various teams, and so it's not really, we haven't tried to fully prescribe these are the criteria by which you take it to this person, but because there's this collaborative approach and ongoing effort, that there's this culture of bouncing it off other people anyway and bringing these things to us. The areas where multiple people get involved are generally where the data collection or use is more sensitive, or it's a new paradigm. You know, so we're introducing biometric technologies for the first time, for example, or when we first had location-based services in our mobile platform. At moments like that, where there's a sort of a new data collection and use paradigm, tend to be the times when these broader teams get involved.
Great. Aaron, tell us about Facebook.
Yeah, I'm trying to build upon what both of you guys said because it's very similar. I mean, we're smaller. We're a smaller organization. So at this moment, we still have more of a centralized, what we call a XFN, cross-functional review, which essentially is a privacy review process. So we have a team on the ground in Menlo Park whose job it is, first and foremost, to train every engineer and product manager who comes in the door on privacy, on sort of the commitments we've made, on what's going on, but most importantly on the process. What we want to make sure that these folks understand when they come in the door, they may not remember everything about notice and consent and those issues, but they have to come through this cross-functional review before any product can launch. And so right now we have this one team that manages and understands every product that's coming down the pike. We have a long list of sort of here's what's coming. We have a cross-functional team who's obligated to review every product. And so someone from policy, my team, someone from legal, someone from marketing, someone from site integrity, someone from our security team, someone from our comms team. So we all get together. We talk through these issues, as Brendan said. The escalation path really depends on, it can depend on sensitivity of the data, whether it comes to me, whether it goes to Mark. It can, you know, there's some things where you're just changing the color of something. It'll still go through at this moment, our cross-functional. I think as we get bigger to the size of Google and Microsoft, we're going to have to think through whether or not it makes sense to sort of put these folks embedded in different vertical teams. But right now it's working. Folks are coming through the cross-functional. And the key there is making sure that they view us as real partners. They see value. They want to launch products that that people will trust and use. And the last thing they want is an advocate or the Wall Street Journal or someone raising concerns about a product. So they really view our contributions. They view it. They take it back. And so far it's been working really well.
That's great. So I hope what we've heard in this first round of questions is that privacy is not a single thing within organizations. There are actually many aspects to privacy, and that the management of privacy goes far beyond just a core compliance team. It actually spreads out across an organization. Whether the model is distributed like Google and Microsoft or more centralized like Facebook, there is a risk assessment process that's going through. There's a process where engineers and IT professionals are going through a privacy impact assessment, a review, a process, so that they can make better decisions about privacy design questions within products or services. Looks like we have our first question. Why don't we go straight to a microphone?
Thank you, Dave Purcell. I have just finished caring for a dementia sufferer. I have a friend who has a similar problem in Africa with her mother. I would request the panel at least think about, in your processes, where there is a duty of care, perhaps to children. Facebook has a policy of no under 13s. If you go to a primary school under 12, you can usually find out the sniggers tell you the kids have accounts. Does the duty of care to people, dementia, children, pregnant teens, is it respected in your processes? Obviously, it's very easy for a process-bound offshore call center to say, well, because of privacy. Thank you.
Great. So let me capture the question and then direct it to the panel. The question was related to classes of customers which may be more suspect, more vulnerable, and deserve a higher duty of care. I think that's a legitimate and reasonable question. Let me frame it this way for all of you, and that is, your organizations introduce novel features, technologies that break boundaries. Brendan talked about it already, that sometimes there are new ideas that you want to launch upon the marketplace. And within those, you're going to have to create some mechanism to educate your customers, to protect your customers, to help them understand not only the benefits of this emerging technology, but the potential risks. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to give each of you something that your company has done, which sort of falls into that category. Don't worry, it won't hurt. maybe just a bit. And I'd like you to talk about what that duty of care looked like, what that consumer education process looked like, how you think about that from a privacy management perspective. So here they are. For Microsoft, you introduced with Kinect a room sensing ability that could identify individuals as they walked into a room. There was individual identifiability. Google Glass created a whole new concept of privacy with the ability to record through wearable technology, video or photos or other things. And Facebook, I think there's a fascinating transition that occurred from the early phase of Facebook to the launch of Newsfeed, where there was a major outcry about all of a sudden the change in perhaps the level of obscurity that existed with Facebook prior to. So each of those changed the rules of the road and raised questions about privacy. What did the management process look like before those went to market? And did anything surprise you after they were in the market? And what does the remediation process look like as you sort of react to what consumer norms appear to be or regulator and advocate concerns appear to be? Brendan, we'll start with you.
I think that's a good example, Trevor, of, you know, because with the Kinect device, you know, with the Xbox 360, it was really bringing facial recognition into the living room for the first time. So this was one of those cases where the model I described earlier worked really well. You know, the team that was embedded, the privacy team in Xbox at the time, we've now consolidated, and it's called the Operating Systems Group. It's the same, a broader team that looks after Windows and Xbox and mobile phone operating systems as well. But they were really at the forefront of trying to assess the risk in this new environment and really apply the core principles of privacy. Is like what data collection makes sense for us? What can we still provide this cool functionality of being able to automatically identify and log people into Xbox Live service when they walk into the living room? But with a minimal amount of data coming to us, you know, or that could be vulnerable for third parties. What limits on use might there be? How do we build a notice and choice experience in? So applying those core processes, and what that led to was a lot of design decisions which limited the impact of privacy. You know, first of all, it wasn't capturing an image of the face. It was just measuring various geometric points on the face and recording that in a sort of using an algorithm to record some unique hash for that face, that even if somebody could hack into the device, it would be meaningless to them, as an example. That stayed local to the device. There was no need for that to be on the server because the user scenario here was simply to authenticate you to that device, which was physically in the room. So there was no need for that to be on a Microsoft server. So examples like that really came to bear, and it was a mixture. It was mainly that frontline privacy team dealing with it. And then we set some new standards out of that, you know, that for then we had standards that we could apply more broadly to the company as other parts of the company were looking at leveraging similar techniques and technologies. And then, you know, because we knew it was going to be sensitive externally, we proactively engaged with a range of stakeholder groups, whether they be regulators or consumer groups, to explain what this new paradigm was, explain the privacy protections we'd put in place so that when it would successfully land into market, and it did in that case. And to the question that was raised as well, you know, this was particularly sensitive because a lot of users of this were children. A lot of gaming on the Xbox platform is children. So that it was certainly a sensitive population. And more generally, I think the point is that that we, and I would think all of us, really do look at what are the differences for various populations, whether it's vulnerable populations like children or the elderly, and what can we put in place to protect them. And we do a lot of work in schools, for example. A lot of schools are using our devices or the Office platform, the OneNote note-taking capabilities. And we've made certain decisions on how we collect and use data in those environments and signed a student privacy pledge to really reinforce the fact that we really have strong data use limitations for children because we want to ensure that the data there is only used for educational purposes. So that's an example of how we deal with it from a policy perspective as opposed to the technology mitigations we put in place with the Connect.
So Aaron, tell us about Newsfeed, because when we think of Facebook today, I think we think of it as Newsfeed. You know,
right.
that is the function. And in some ways, you had to change the expectations of Facebook customers in launching Newsfeed, even though there was some privacy friction associated with that change.
Yeah, and I think this is one of our challenges is as we continue to evolve how Facebook looks and feels. You know, what are sort of the underlying core principles that we're going to honor? And I think in Newsfeed, and you saw also when we launched our graph search product that enables people to search for things. In both the Newsfeed example and in the graph search example, we're enabling people who could otherwise see the same content to see it in a different way. So with the Newsfeed example, you could have gone to people's timelines and you could have seen that, but you would have had to go from, you know, to Brendan's and then to Trevor's. But instead, Newsfeed now put it all together so you could just see a constant stream. Now, again, we're honoring the audience choice, so you can only see in your Newsfeed what you could otherwise see if you went to someone's timeline. But I think, as Trevor raised, it raises this issue of, but you're making it easier to find me. Same thing with Graph Search when we launched a product where people could search for things. Again, you could have gone to someone's timeline and found those things, but if you wanted to search for photos of Brendan, you now can do that in a way, and you can pull up photos. So in both of those instances, it's really a privacy by obscurity issue. And so we looked a lot at that. And so some of the things that we did, first and foremost, so we do millions of privacy checks a day, right? So every time in your newsfeed, I have a different newsfeed than Trevor, than Brendan, than Keith, because, again, we're making sure that the people who can see that are seeing that. So that's a privacy check. So first and foremost, we had to have the engineering capability to do those privacy checks. The other thing that we did is that we built a lot of controls and brought them in line because we wanted people who didn't like this experience to be able to change it. So before we had your controls over in one other place in your settings page, we brought those in line. We also created a means by which you can, with one switch, if anything you've posted publicly, you can ratchet that down to friends. If you're nervous about, you know, who can see things if they're searching. We have ways in which you can bulk untag yourself from photos. So what we try to do is build a lot of controls so that people can, if they're worried about this, again, we're not violating a true privacy principle because we're honoring the audience setting that you have. But if you don't like the fact that it's being displayed in this new way, you can control it in various ways. And so as Facebook continues to evolve, we're going to continue to have these challenges of we may want to show things to people in a different way. It's sometimes that's difficult. We want to make sure people aren't surprised by it. We want to delight people with our products. But we have to make sure that if people don't like it, they have a control, they have a way to deal with that. Just really quickly on the minors issue, because I think it's a really important one. As part of this cross-functional team, I failed to mention we have a safety person who actually sits on that team and looks at the minors issue. And I'll give an example of, so with every product launch, we look at it from a minors perspective. So we have a product that's called Tag Suggest, which is a product that uses facial recognition to suggest you to your friends so that your friends can tag you in photos. As you know, if you upload a photo on the web today, someone could take a photo of us all here today. Someone could upload it in the web, and none of us up here on this panel would know that it exists. The beauty of tagging on Facebook, at least, is that you're notified that the photo exists. So we have a tag suggest feature so that if someone in this audience uploaded a photo, we might be suggested to be tagged. Now, I love this because I want to be suggested because I want to know that the photo exists so that I can do something about it. But it does involve the use of facial recognition, and so we decided, though, because minors, we do believe, is a more sensitive, vulnerable group, that feature is not available to minors. So that's an example of we look at different features and we calibrate for those audiences.
Keith, tell us about Google Glass and some of the privacy risk management that went into that.
Sure. It's interesting. There are a number of common themes, I think, that I'm hearing coming across. these various launches. Glass was, for me and for Google, a tremendous learning experience. It taught us a lot about launching innovative products that are aimed at helping users integrate technology more into their lives, doing that responsibly, doing that in a manner that's consistent with their expectations, and remaining cognizant of the fact that that use of technology is going to impact other people besides the individual user themselves. Now, that was one of the things we learned. There was, of course, some surprise. I think one of the things that we struggled with throughout and we continue to struggle with is the characterization of glass as this radically revolutionary technology. From our view, it was evolutionary, right? The idea that a device that someone could carry around with them and take pictures or videos of the things in the world around them was wildly disruptive felt a little overstated. But we heard that signal better than we had probably received that kind of feedback in the past. We were very cautious in our launch, very considered in our launch. And I think more than ever before, we were sensitive to the fact that there was this incredible diversity of requirements and considerations that we needed to balance to make sure that we were moving this technology, making this technology available to people in a way that was going to make the world better and make their lives better. So some of the things that are obvious, there's a diversity of legal requirements all around the world. When you think about taking video images, taking pictures of people, using technologies like facial recognition, there are various legal requirements. There's not a ton of law yet, though. So law really wasn't the place to look to set the bar on how we bring this product to market. However, we learned a lot about user expectations. We got a lot of feedback from folks about the way this technology was going to be perceived when it hit the market. So one of the things we did that went far above and beyond any legal requirement at the time was we affirmatively went out and said that we were not going to allow facial recognition technology on glassware until some unspecified point in the future when the world was ready for it. And we didn't know when that was. And we didn't draw a line in the sand saying when that would be. We just said, we are not going to allow this now because the feedback that we are getting from our users and from the world is that they're not quite ready for it yet. And we took some criticism for that, as well as some positive feedback, in part because people are constantly balancing restraints on innovation, not allowing app developers to launch what they might believe is the next killer app because the marketplace, they may not be quite ready for it yet. Balancing all of that against, on the other side, trying to really listen to individual users. Users are going to use your technology in ways that you can't fully anticipate at the time that you design it. And you need to keep an ear to the ground and make sure that you understand how are the users going to use this technology, how can we iterate upon it so that we're making it as valuable and useful for our users as it can possibly be, and at the same time protecting these really important values of privacy that our users are perpetually reminding us that, you know, this is really important to them, it means something to them.
So this is a great way to capture, I think, the fact that many of these technology companies, large and small, are creating new technological environments for us to experience. These technologies mediate our lives, and in many cases, that changes the way in which we use data, experience privacy, and as a result, we need people like Brendan, Keith, and Aaron who struggle with these issues and try to find the right answers, but that frequently means going beyond or looking past what existing law there is because sometimes the law is not sufficient to answer many of these questions. Okay, we're going to go to one more question. Go ahead.
I just was wanting to know, like, if there's any incentives or in your companies to educate users about the length, the longevity of data that once it gets posted to your services. Because in reality, the currency that's used to pay for your services is people's data. And I see very little education, you know, from the services to let people know that, hey, once you put something up there, it's probably going to be there forever. And there could be ramifications, like when you go get a job, there are companies that specialize in searching people's profiles for background checks. I see really, like, absolutely zero attempt from the companies to educate people on the longevity of that content. And I look at, like, removed from timeline, sort of like compared to the undo the sent email in Outlook, right? Like, if it's been up there for any length of time at all, it's probably somewhere else. So I just wanted to get your perspective on that and see what you have to say.
So I'm going to ask the panel to respond quickly because we're actually going to pick up some of these themes, hopefully, if we have time, in a a dialogue that we hope to have about the right to be forgotten. And so quickly, maybe one of you could talk to us about data latency and how your organizations feel. And this might be, well, it's actually relevant for all three of you, but one of you tell us how your organization looks at the latency of data and the ability to delete and manage data within your services. Who'd like to handle that? Erin.
Well, I'm happy to start. Well, first of all, I think it's a really important point, education. So we try. I mean, I posted blogs about, you know, we had issues where employers were asking employees for passwords, and I was basically posted a blog like, guys, you know, you don't need to be doing that. So you don't need to be revealing that information. And so, and I also have an Ask the CPO page where, and we post things to educate people, and we try to do in-product education as well about that. Now, on Facebook, you can delete anything you've posted. So you can go and delete it, and we actually do delete it. We have an obligation to delete it from our servers within 30 to 60 days. And we do delete information from our servers. But you're right that if something's up there, someone could snapshot it, someone could take it, and someone could do something with it. And so, again, it's incumbent upon us to be educating people about this. And we do a lot of education in the minor space. So actually, with minors, before they post something, if they want to post something to everyone, to public, we actually put up a notice that says, do you know what this means? Public means everyone, anyone can see it. And what that means is that they can then snapshot it, essentially. And so we are doing more of that education. I think you can never do enough of this to make sure people understand that. But on Facebook, you can delete your information. You can actually download your information. We have a download your information tool. You can take it with you. So we are building more and more tools that enable people to delete and download while also doing education, which is critical.
Okay, we're going to go rapid fire. One more question from over here.
Very simple question. What's been the biggest privacy mistake your firms have made, and why did it happen?
I'm sorry, I didn't.
What's been the biggest privacy mistake your firms have made, and why did it happen?
So the question is, what is the biggest privacy mistake that your firms have made, and why did it happen? Who'd like to start? And there we are. Actually, to be fair, I think Keith said that there have been some missteps at Google. Yeah. You've launched some products that you've changed course on. Facebook has certainly launched some things that you've learned from.
I think Beacon might be a good example of this was before my time, but this was a product that I think everyone, again, thought it was really, really interesting to enable people to connect and share about what they're purchasing, but it had ramifications. Again, people were surprised by it, and that's people... because I didn't know that you were sharing what I'm buying with my friends. We had a similar, we started to do social reading, where you could go and read an article on a publication, and that was shared back to your friends. And people didn't understand that. So what we've done now is, well, first of all, there's no more Beacon product, but also on the sharing, on these sort of social reader type sharing, we've actually bifurcated the going to an app and doing something, and then if they want to share that back to your friends, a separate notice comes up so that you understand that and can consent to it. So a lot of these things, it's about our mission is to connect and share. We see real value in that. I think the question is, and we have to make sure we're doing it, like we've all talked about, in the context of what people expect and not having undue surprises. And so we learn from these things, and we do better.
So let me add a theme now, because it actually is a place where I think your organizations are stuck a little bit between a rock and a hard place, and that is government access to your customers' data. Your companies really are stuck when it comes to national security interests in the U.S. and around the world. Consumers expect you to protect their data. Clearly, that is the case. They expect you to protect their data. But governments also expect you to cough up data when presented with valid legal requests for that data. How do you guys balance those interests? How do you look at erring on the side of providing greater privacy-enhancing features for your customers, like encryption, or governments that actually challenge you when you want to enable things like encryption, and they tell you that provides a safe haven for nefarious actors in the world. So without diving fully into the Edward Snowden world and those sorts of things, how do you balance those interests when you have two very legitimate interests?
Sure.
And Keith, and then Brendan.
Okay. Sure. I will. It's true that there's a balancing of interests here, right? And it's important that we don't lose sight of the fact that governments do have an important role in protecting their citizens. We recognize that. Sometimes I think it's cast as adversarial between us and them. In fact, what Google's commitment is and has long been is we want to promote transparency around law enforcement access to user information. We want to provide strong tools to keep users in control. And we want to make sure that existing legal processes for legitimate government access to data work appropriately so that we can push governments to use the front door, to use legitimate, transparent, accountable legal process to access information. And we will not, have not, and have no intention of collaborating with any effort to give governments information through the back door. We want them to use legitimate, transparent, accountable legal process.
Brendan.
Yeah, absolutely the same in that regard. You know, there is this legitimate role that governments play in protecting communities, but that cannot be at the expense of values like privacy that we cherish. And so for us, it's very similar to Google. We want to ensure that there is any, you know, collection of data from our customers by governments, any government, is through valid legal process. So the encryption, role of encryption is very important because it helps to ensure that data is collected only via legal process and not by any technical brute force. And then it's ensuring that the legal processes are fine as well. And so what us and other companies are doing is also, in terms of our own policy, in addition to our own policies, is advocating for modifications of laws, you know, to ensure that the privacy protections are upheld. Electronic Communications Privacy Act here in the U.S. is a good example where, you know, we believe that an email that is printed and stored in my filing cabinet at home should have exactly the same protection as the protection should be the same for the copy that's on the server and our data center as well. And right now, those things are not quite at that same level of protection. Same things on cross-border. We've got a case right now against the U.S. government relating to access to customer data stored outside the U.S. From a foreign customer. And there is the case is about the U.S. government trying to get access because the records are on our servers and we're a U.S. company. And we're really pushing back strongly because there's a fundamental principle at play here that there is valid legal process for governments to get access to that data, and they should use that and not try and use us as the middleman.
Great. We're going to go rapid fire to questions because we have more people that want to ask questions than we have time. So one here quickly and one there, and keep your question to just 10 seconds if you can.
Ms. Egan, looking forward to future Facebook applications, the acquisition of Oculus Rift raises really interesting possibilities. Mr. Zuckerberg has talked about augmented reality, virtual reality platforms. Since that's probably hot and heavy at Facebook now, can you give us the number one privacy issue that's come up in developing those platforms and maybe what the processes are in Facebook to address them?
Cool.
Yeah. So Oculus will be like any of our affiliated companies, part of our cross-functional review process. I don't have one for you that's particularly like the number one privacy risk. I think the kinds of issues that I think Brendan mentioned with Connect, I mean, we're looking forward to getting into the virtual reality space and understanding and unpacking the issues, but there hasn't been one that I can say has come that's particularly interesting for this.
But
one.
Inevitably, there will be something.
Yeah, there
right?
will
one
be.
Has
and,
to imagine
and so,
augmented
again, what
reality.
We're doing is we're yeah. training the folks on again, what our process is like, and they get it, and they understand that what they have to do is they have to come through this cross-functional review privacy process, and they will, and we will see what those issues are.
Great.
I'm Tom Keenan. I wrote a book called Techno Creep. Your companies are all in it. One of the things, I guess it's a question for Aaron, Facebook spawned the malware industry of use this application to find out who's looked at your profile. Now, as I understand it, that's a functionality that you don't offer, but bad guys purport to offer it. So how do you deal with something like that? Because it's a complicated privacy issue, people looking at your profile.
So bad guys are offering tools for people to, yeah. So, and that's scraping, that's
yeah,
against our
social
terms.
Yeah, social media scraping,
so,
I think. Scoble,
right, so
yeah.
right. So that's against our terms, and if we find out about it, we actively enforce it.
But maybe you should offer the functionality
should
so
offer
they
the
don't
functionality.
Exist.
People like that functionality. People want to know how many people have been looking. I mean, again, it's a no one on the product side has found that people, there's been a sort of strong user interest in that. We do surveys all the time, 4,000 a day, people on our service, about what's interesting, what would they like to see, what are some of the new features. That has not risen to the top. I think it has some countervailing concerns. I mean, you know, I think a lot of people look on Facebook and maybe look up old friends, trying to see what they're doing, and maybe that would, they wouldn't if that happened, but maybe that's, so I think there's countervailing balance of interest. We haven't seen a strong push for that feature from people. If you guys in the audience think that'd be really great, then let us know.
Well, LinkedIn sells it, right?
Okay. Let's move on to the legislative landscape, and we'll come to one more round of questions before we close. I want to talk about some of the major legislative initiatives that we see in the world today, one in the U.S., one in Europe. In the United States, the Obama administration, with some fanfare, just 2 months ago, announced that they would reintroduce the Consumer Privacy Bill of Rights. And almost immediately, there was consensus that the Consumer Privacy Bill of Rights would not see much traction on the Hill, that it was a bill that would not move forward. Now, some of your organizations have come out in support of broad-based consumer privacy legislation in the United States. There are some new ideas in the Consumer Privacy Bill of Rights, privacy review boards, contextual risk, accountability. What should we expect from this bill? Is it really just a start of a conversation, or does it really have some legislative legs that we should be paying attention to? And we'll go quick on this. So maybe, Brendan, you can start, and if anyone else has something new to add, we can jump in.
I would say it feels like a continuation of a conversation rather than a start. Perhaps it's a new chapter of the existing conversation. Microsoft has been, you know, on the record since, well, 10 years now, saying we think the time is right for federal privacy legislation in the U.S. And we've been asked to predict many times what will happen soon, and nothing really has. But there has been a lot of good dialogue. And I think, you know, I view this partially as one of the benefits of the dialogue is to really get something solid that works, that appropriately balances innovation and privacy to a state where when something is ready to move in Congress, that there's something that's well thought out. And so I feel like that's the state of it. It's a really good topic to be talking about. The rest of the world is kind of looking at us as well and thinking, you know, this model is very different in the U.S. because it's very sectoral and state-driven, and wondering if a more comprehensive approach will work with helping with the global interoperability as well.
So Keith or Aaron, do either of you feel that this bill, as it currently stands, has any chance of passage in its current format? Probably not. Yeah.
But I do think it's an important model for internationalized regimes in Europe and around the world are looking at privacy. I think it's an important model. It sort of brings new ideas, as you mentioned, into the conversation. So we're not talking about this simple sort of notice and control. It has a whole accountability framework to it.
Yep.
You know, so we all talked about our privacy programs, whatever we call them. That's really important. And so as legislators around the world are thinking about that, we hope that they look to what the White House has done as a model.
So let's shift in the U.S. from the legislative to the regulatory and enforcement side of things. And I think just in the last 2 weeks, there's been a really, I think, striking development in that space. And that is that There really is a new cop on the beat when it comes to information privacy. That's the Federal Communications Commission. And in their net neutrality decision, it basically made internet service providers common carriers, which basically took them from FTC enforcement into FCC enforcement. So they broadened the scope of FCC enforcement capabilities. And within the FCC, they have more tools, more weapons in the way of, or in their ability to go after privacy violations in the marketplace. So within the last 2 weeks, we saw a $25 million fine against AT&T for privacy concerns associated with call centers that AT&T had contracted with in Mexico. It feels like in the United States, there is less legislation, but a lot more enforcement and a lot more focus on malfeasance in the marketplace, and that risk environment may be actually the most perilous in the world, because if you get it wrong, there are fairly large fines that stand on the other side of that. Do anyone want to comment on that? Do you agree that enforcement dynamic is really the one telling indicator in the U.S.?
I'm happy to jump in. I think it is, and I think this is what's so important is when we're talking, what we worry about with the call for sort of comprehensive privacy legislation in the U.S. is that it sends a signal internationally that somehow the U.S. regime is not strong on privacy. And
right.
It is strong on privacy, as you mentioned, the FCC enforcement, FTC enforcement, state AG enforcement, unfair and deceptive trade practices, as well as the sector-specific laws. So we actually have a very robust privacy regime, and that's, I think, a really important message that we want to make sure international counterparts understand as they're thinking about ensuring the free flow of information between our countries. So I think it is really important.
So the U.S. shouldn't be as apologetic
as
it might be with regards to a lack of privacy legislation in the U.S. Okay, really quickly, questions from the floor.
Which ties directly into what Aaron just said. All three of your companies are involved in or have been involved in court cases and regulatory investigations in the EU. Could you just comment on where you think that's likely to end up? Are you going to end up having to offer data protection of the EU style over across America, or are we going to end up with two separate environments with data managed separately?
That what a great and massive question. So, so the question is for everyone in the audience, EU regulatory demands are increasing and they are increasingly extraterritorial. How are your organizations balancing those demands, and are you thinking of a segmented approach where Europe gets European privacy and the rest of the world gets something else, or a global approach? And does that mean that the European regulatory approach wins because it's the highest common denominator in order to set a global standard? Who wants to take that?
Sure, Keith. I'll jump in on that one. So we have probably had as much dialogue with European regulators as any company in the world. I will say we are committed, as we always have been, to providing the best possible product and service to every Google user everywhere in the world. That means the best privacy protection, the best privacy controls, the best security to every Google user everywhere in the world. We have no intention of fragmenting that and providing a better service in one place than we do in another place because the law requires it in some place. That said, we do certainly, and I think any international company now has to take a hard look at, in order to satisfy some specific regulatory idiosyncrasies or specific demands from regulators in a certain country, you may end up with some fragmentation of your offerings. But I wouldn't say that that's a model for better privacy protection in the EU. In fact, if we learn things from our engagement with regulators in the European Union that are better for privacy, that help us develop better privacy controls and better products and services, we're going to make those available to our users all over the world.
Yeah, and just 2 seconds on that myself. We have actually headquartered ourselves in Ireland. So we have a Facebook Ireland, and we comply with EU data protection law. And so across sort of the world, we do. But I think the real risk in Europe is not a Europe versus US. What we're seeing now is within Europe, 28 member states actually having different privacy regimes. So right now, we've been working with the Irish Data Protection Commission as this regulation is moving forward in Europe, this concept of a one-stop shop. So you have one regulator who audits your practices. Our practices have been audited. There's an audit report that's made public about Facebook practices in Europe and how they comply with EU data protection law. And we made changes to our service for users worldwide in response to the Irish Data Protection Commission, such as more education, et cetera. So, but what I'm worried about now with what's happening in Europe is that there's going to be 28 different member states having different legal regimes, and that's going to be really hard, not just for our companies, which are big, but really for the small app developers and small innovators in Europe and around the world. So that's the real risk I'm worried about.
Okay. Looks like we lost our last question, which actually opens us up for a wrap-up. We have just over 2 minutes left. And in those last 2 minutes, I'm going to give you each 30 seconds to tell us how you think privacy will be different in 5 years. What drivers are going to change the way we think about privacy? Will it be technology, consumer expectations, law? What's going to be different? Give us one or two ideas that you see in your crystal ball. Brendan, you want to start?
Sure. I think, you know, it's very clear, and you may have picked this up around this conference and others, that the next big wave is the Internet of Things. As we digitize the physical world, Not only is it going to mean that computing becomes much more pervasive, it's also going to become much more personal, and the data flows will be of a much larger volume, all stored in the cloud. So the privacy implications of that, I think, are going to become more public. Become more aware of it as technology is now intersecting more of my daily life, and that there's ultimately record keeping and footprints of my daily activities stored everywhere. What does that mean for my privacy? So I think that's where the privacy profession will be spending a lot of the next 5 years, is working out what's appropriate in that realm. How do we introduce the concepts of data ethics into the big data world that comes partially, fed by the Internet of Things, is really where a lot of the future of privacy will be in the next 5 years.
Great. So the Internet of Things, data ethics, how we solve privacy in that new realm. Keith.
Sure. We're going to see technology continue challenging traditional notions and conceptions of privacy. I don't think anybody disputes that. I think the law is going to continue to struggle. We're going to continue seeing legal regimes around the world trying to figure out ways to protect traditional norms and to do so in a way that hopefully will remain sensitive to data-driven innovation and allowing users to realize the benefits of technology. In terms of where I think that takes us technologically, I think you're going to see smart companies doubling down on investing in user controls and ways to keep users empowered with respect to the way information about them is being used to drive value.
That's great. So more complexity, more user controls. Aaron.
I completely agree. I was going to say privacy-enhancing technology sort of 3.0, identity management, enabling people to really be at the center of controlling their information. And our hope is that in the legislative realm, again, because regulations are moving around the world, maybe not in the U.S., but around the world, that are going to have serious implications. What we're hoping is that with the true accountability, these programs that we all have where we're all assessing risk on a day-to-day basis, plus these technological tools that put people in control and at the center of managing their data, we need to understand those things and then figure out what does that mean for the legislative framework. There's a role for legislation, but we've got to make sure that it doesn't undercut these other really promising developments.
So let me close with my answer to the question, and that is that I think that technology will continue to challenge our concepts of privacy, and law will always be a lagging response. It will never be sufficient. And between that leading edge of technology and that lagging front end of public policy, we will find enormous amounts of business practices in an unstable and unpredictable, complex, risk-filled world. That's going to mean that a lot of organizations get it wrong, but it also is going to create an imperative, I think, in the marketplace for organizations to drive privacy understanding, drive a privacy issue spotting to everyone who makes decisions about data. And one reason that I feel optimistic about that future, given the complexity, given the challenges and risk, is that we have great privacy leaders working on solving those problems for us in large organizations. So I hope you will join me in thanking our panel for their great work. Thank you.